I'm using GPS for a very specific reason. Those are intelligent systems. As far as I'm concerned, those are the closest things we've ever designed to intelligent systems, because they can actually orient, right? They orient in real time. And they're unbelievably sophisticated systems, right? Because they rely on a huge satellite network and so on. And they're cybernetic systems, technically speaking. They respond very much like the way that we respond. So anyways, you know, you inhabit a map. You try to adjust the resolution of the map so that it's no more complex than it needs to be to get you from point A to point B. That's it. You want minimal resolution, because that enables efficient cognitive processing. It doesn't overload you too much. Like, when I'm looking at this room, if I look, say I want to walk down this pathway, basically what my mind does, my perceptual field, and you can detect this, if I look straight ahead, I can barely see you people on the periphery. You're kind of like blurs. You two, I can tell that you have heads, but that's about it. When you move, I can see your hand. I can probably see your eyes, but barely. So you're all very low resolution. And even though I can't detect it, at the very periphery of my vision, you guys are black and white. So my color vision disappears at the periphery, even though I can't actually perceive that. So what happens is, if I want to walk down here, this pathway becomes high resolution. It becomes marked with positive emotion. All of this turns into low resolution. Back here, it's not even represented. And then I find out, well, am I doing this properly? And the answer is, well, I walk forward. And if I get to the goal, then I've done it properly enough. And if, you know, one of you stand up and get in my way, then I'm going to focus on you and assume instantly that I haven't mapped you properly, right? I put you in the category of irrelevant entity, when in fact, you happen to be in the category of strange object, the thing that objects. And so, well, so then we inhabit those structures all the time. We're in a structure like that, a perceptual structure. And if it's working, then it's got the archetypal quality of paradise, so to speak, because its axioms are correct and it's functional. And then now and then something comes along, and that's what the snake is, the eternal snake in the garden, that pops up inside a structure, and it turns out that the things that you weren't attending to are the most important things rather than the least important things. And that, what does that do? It blows the map into pieces. And that can happen at different levels of severity, but at the ultimate level of severity, it's apocalyptic, right? Everything goes, and that's a traumatic intrusion. And essentially, the story of the Garden of Eden is the story of a traumatic intrusion. That's exactly what it is. And so what happens is that Adam and Eve are living in unconscious bliss, roughly speaking. Everything's fine. They're in their walled garden. They're in a paradisal state. They're not aware of their own vulnerability or nakedness, so they're not suffering from negative emotion. Something pops up that radically expands their vision, and all of a sudden now they can apprehend all sorts of things that exist as threats. So that's their own nakedness and vulnerability, and temporality itself, because they become aware of the future, and bang, that state of being in that paradise is forever gone. That's the strange thing about human beings. This is what happened to us, I think, is that our perceptions developed to such a degree that we could no longer ignore what was irrelevant. We couldn't do it, because we discovered, roughly speaking, once we discovered our finite limitations in time and space, we discovered that we were surrounded by infinite threat. Always. And maybe that's why people are so hyper awake, because threat wakes you up. Well, we're in a constant state of existential threat. Now, the advantage to that is that we take arms up against a sea of troubles constantly. That's the advantage, right? And we build enclosures, and we take precautions for the future, and we live a very long time, and we generally live quite safe lives compared to the lives we could live. And so we've traded pain for anxiety. That's another way of thinking about it.